Palm Sunday and then to Easter. And I was looking over Scripture this past week and asking the Lord what I should highlight in this part of Scripture that leads us to the triumphal entry where he comes into Jerusalem riding on the donkey. And we're going to talk about that next week in the shouts of Hosanna. But one of the Scriptures that really stood out to me was three verses that we have in Matthew chapter 19, where the Lord is making his way towards Jerusalem. And along the way, we come to this small section of Scripture that's very, very significant. Now, how many of us know that it's not by a chance that anything is in the Bible the way that it is? Some folks say, oh, why is that there? God is intentional. You know, every piece that he has put into his word is there for a reason, to teach us, to reveal to us his heart and his truth. So we come to these three verses here, Matthew chapter 19, verses 13 through 15, and it says these words for us. The little children were brought to Jesus for him to place his hands on them and pray for them, but the disciples rebuked those who brought them. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." When he had placed his hands on them, he went on from there. Now, what do we do when we put our hand on somebody? We bless them. He's blessing them. He's blessing the children. And he shows their value and their importance in the overall scheme of things. Let's pray together. Lord God, we thank you for this passage. Help us to see why it's there this morning. Help us, Lord, to know your heart for children. Lord, help us to understand each opportunity and to welcome and to bring each to you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for this time together. Speak, Lord, through my mouth, we ask. Amen. So our key, I'm gonna let the cat out of the bag early. The key point here is that we, as the adults, are the gateway to Jesus for our children. Some of you are like, but I don't have any birth children of my own. A lot of you are uncles or aunts or grandmothers or grandfathers or whatever it is, we all have children that we influence in one way or another. And so this really is for all of us today, not just for those of you who have small children. It's really for all of us. And even bigger children need to hear this from us as well. There are certain things. Well, let's think back to this. So think back with me to when you were a child. And don't give me that, I can't remember that far back. You can. Let's all go back and remember the things that you were concerned about, the questions that you had, the things that you didn't know, the things that you wanted to figure out. I must have asked hundreds of questions, probably to my parents' annoyance, all the times I didn't understand and I wanted to know certain things. And so remember back to those times. You know, and as children, there's so much that we don't understand. We're naive, we're innocent, hopefully, most of us. And we're trying to figure out what it's all about. You know, not only how to have a good time, but why we're here, and we're trying to figure out. I mean, this idea that there are so many that are taught that the world is without God is so sad. I saw an article about the public schools. If you want to hear this, it's actually pretty good. There was a man named Stephen Girard. Has anyone heard of Stephen Girard? Mystery folks. Well, in 1844, he was the fourth richest man in America. And when he died, he had an estate of about $7 million. And he left all the money to start a college in Philadelphia for boys, orphans, age 6 to 18. And he put in the will, I enjoin and require that no ecclesiastic, missionary, or minister of any denomination or Christian sect whatsoever shall hold or exercise any station or duty in the college, nor shall any person ever be admitted for any purpose as a visitor on the premises. This is a guy who did not like the idea of the Christian faith in his school. And so Gerard's heirs hired a man named Daniel Webster. Has anyone ever heard of Daniel Webster? Known as the defender of the Constitution, as the lawyer who would prosecute the case. Webster was so well known that when it was found out that he was on the other side, oftentimes the lawyers against him would withdraw their petition. He was that good. Let me make sure I read this thing right here. The right one. So the requirement excluded religious teachings from the school to be established under the government's authority. This was the first time in history this had ever happened. And so Webster went before the Supreme Court for 3 days, and he attacked the school for its anti-Christian posture, telling the court these words: "The plan of education proposed by Mr. Gerard is derogatory to the Christian religion and tends to weaken people's reverence for that religion and their conviction of its authority and importance, and therefore in its general character tends to mischievous and not useful ends. The proposed school is to be founded on plain and clear principles and for plain and clear objects of infidelity when proposed to them." But he quoted, I read better in my mind before I read it to you all here now. He quoted Matthew 19:14, where he said, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them." That was the basis of his argument before the Supreme Court. And he won. I'm going to go back over here to where hopefully it makes more sense. The attorneys agreed the purest principles of morality should be taught in any government school. Where are they to be found? Whoever searches for them must go to the source from which a Christian person derives their faith, the Bible. There is an obligation to teach in all schools what the Bible alone can teach, a pure system of morality. Isn't it incredible that that's what they decided in 1844 in light of how far the society has swung away from Christian doctrine? There is great, great, great opportunity for us with our children, and we are the gateway to Jesus for them. I want to share a personal story. When I was in the fifth grade, I grew up at La Jolla Presbyterian Church in San Diego. We went every Sunday. My family was very consistent. And when I was there, I had a fifth grade teacher. Her name was Mrs. Boykin. And I was a very shy, introverted, awkward, quiet kid. People wonder how I got here. That's another story. But she took an interest in me, and she liked the creativity, and that I liked stories, and so she got me a picture Bible. Old picture Bibles. It reads like a comic book. And it was from that picture Bible that I fell in love with God's Word. For the first time, I fell in love with God's Word. I fell in love with the story of God's people and his interactions with them and how he was so redemptive and the person of Christ through a picture Bible that I was given by this fifth grade teacher. There was no church program to give every kid a Bible. There was no recognition of Mrs. Boykin as this exemplary teacher. She just took an interest in one of her students and bestowed upon me God's Word and said, "This is for you. You're going to like it." And that's her legacy. When you think about it, I don't know what else she did. I haven't read about her in the papers. But now I've given my own daughter, my third grader, that same picture Bible, and she's read through it now twice and gotten God's message through that. That's legacy. That's incredible impact through a simple gesture. It's important for us to grasp the fact that all children are trying to figure things out. They're wanting to get answers. They don't have it figured out. And if we don't teach them what we know is right, they're finding out another system of thought from somebody else. Because everyone's got to put something somewhere. You've got to have some kind of operating system. Right? We all are looking for that as kids. You know, I read this thing, this actually kind of gets me. I read these things with the parents like, well, I don't want to tell them what to think. But that's actually skipping over responsibility that we have to raise our children right. I read an article, there was a guy who was like, well, I don't want to commit him to anything that he wouldn't like when he's older. You know, and that was his reason for not getting his child circumcised. And I don't know about you, I don't want to do that when I'm older. I want that to happen when I'm not going to remember it. I mean, there are certain things that we have a responsibility to do, especially as believers. Because if I don't communicate it to my kids now, somebody else is giving them another message. And I think for some reason the Christian faith, you know, we get so far away of that simple gospel message to just make disciples of all nations. That's got to start with those that we're given influence over. There's a responsibility because they're looking for something. They're looking for God. You know, and we have so many great opportunities to show interest and model for our kids what they want to see and to know. We have that first command. He says, let them come to me. How do we do that? We engage our kids in understanding what life with God looks like. So bring them to church. I always say that. Bring your kids to church. Help them get involved with a consistent teaching and other kids and where they're, you know, talking about God and working out his heart together. How else do we do it? We do it by the way that we talk about things in our daily lives, okay? Now, I don't want you to over-spiritualize everything, all right? Not everything is got a spiritual message. You don't watch a Disney movie and say, okay, in that Disney film, who was the Christ-like character? Maybe there's not one. That's okay. This is a pastor gave me this great story. They were having a worship service one night, and this very shy high school girl got very excited, and they were playing the music, and she came forward, and she came down, and she got down on her face and was worshiping God, and she stayed there for more than 90 minutes on her face. And they said, oh, you know, and finally the pastor went up to her and said, you know, Jeannie, how are you doing over here? And she said, and she's like, ah! And he says, Jeannie, are you doing okay? And she had gotten her braces stuck in the carpet of the church. It's okay. So we don't want to over-spiritualize things, but we can talk about our faith, especially with our kids in everyday lives. You know, how do I handle a hard situation in light of the fact that Jesus is my Savior? My willingness to forgive, or at least to restore, should look different from the non-believers. How do we talk about, you know, maybe a kid who's a bully with our kids? You know, how do we talk about things that are unfair that we're going through or that they're going through from a perspective that reflects Christ as Lord of our lives? To help them understand that life with him looks very different from life without him. I mean, there's even small things like prayer at the dinner table, prayer before bed, not religious activities, but things that open up the reality of relationship with the living God. So that when we pray for something together and that thing comes true, our kids can see this is real and not just academic exercises. They don't want religion. They do want relationship. They do want what's real. And they're looking for it wherever they can find it. We can model a lifestyle of love and submission to Christ And that starts actually at home. How I relate with my wife reflects my relationship to Christ. How I relate with my brother, my sister, that weird uncle, or the weird aunt, reflects my relationship with Christ, reflects who I am as a Christian. Especially when hard times come, especially when they're difficult, we can reflect that relationship with Christ, that faith component in our lives. I had a friend whose mom would say when they'd go to the fast food place, you can have anything to drink, but you can't have soda with caffeine. She always would say that. And then she'd always get the biggest Dr. Pepper she could find. Well, what do you think the kids wanted to drink all the time? And now they drink big Dr. Peppers. You know, we don't want to be hypocritical. We don't want to pay lip service. We do want to create a reality that they can say, okay, that looks like something, and that looks like what's going to work for me. You'd be surprised. I have met so many kids that are aware of things that aren't right with their folks as opposed to things that are. We have a couple of passages I want to look at. The first one is Mark chapter 10, verse 15. Jesus says this for us again. I tell you the truth, anyone who does not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. Why do we think that's important? Now, I would say to you, it's like this. Children understand they are reliant upon somebody else for what they need. Like, my son cannot go and rent a car and drive to Santa Barbara for a wild weekend. He's six. You know, he needs me to drive him and buy the food and put the gas in the car.
Help us spread the message. Click on the donate button below or go to shermanoakspc.org/donate. Thank you.